Bonjour à tous, mon nom est Justin Vaïsse, je suis le directeur du centre d'analyse, de prévision et de stratégie du Quai d'Orsay, et on m'a demandé de modérer cette session sur le terrorisme. Hier, lors de son discours, le ministre des Affaires étrangères, Jean-Marc Ayrault, a évoqué le terrorisme. Il a parlé d'une menace globale, d'un terrorisme qui se joue des frontières et impose une guerre nouvelle qui frappe nos États et nos sociétés en leur cœur, en combinant l'idéologie la plus rétrograde et les méthodes les plus barbares aux technologies les plus modernes. Ensuite, il a rappelé que la France avait été frappée la dernière fois, le 14 juillet, le jour de la fête nationale. Et il a aussi rappelé l'élan de solidarité qui avait entouré les réactions à cet attentat. Et il avait ajouté, je le cite, « Car la France n'est bien sûr pas la seule à être frappée. Le terrorisme a touché New York, Boston, San Bernardino ou Orlando. Il a fait des ravages à Paris, Nice, Bruxelles, mais aussi à Istanbul, Kaboul, Bagdad, Dhaka, Sirte, Tunis, Bamako, Niamey, Tel Aviv, Ouagadougou, Bombay ou Abidjan. Cette liste macabre n'est pas exhaustive, même si elle est déjà longue, beaucoup trop longue. Nous en connaissons tout le paradoxe. La majorité des victimes de ces terroristes qui se revendiquent de l'islam sont des musulmans. » Et il concluait cet aspect-là, cet aspect sur le terrorisme, en disant « Face au désordre du monde, la seule réponse consiste à unir nos forces, à faire preuve de solidarité et à trouver des solutions collectives à des problèmes communs. » J'ai souhaité mentionner ce discours de Jean-Marc Ayrault hier parce que, au fond, il ouvre la scène, il nous donne une idée du panel qui nous attend et qui répond précisément à cette idée d'unir nos forces collectivement pour résoudre un problème commun. La diversité des membres de ce panel répond en effet à cette exigence, et je mentionnerai brièvement qui sont les intervenants. Vous avez leur biographie dans les livrets. Je demanderai d'abord à Sergei Karaganov, qui est, je le dirai en anglais, le Honorary Chairman of the Presidium of the Non-Governmental Council on Foreign and Defense Policy of Russia, et un habitué, j'ajouterai, de la World Policy Conference, de commencer. Ensuite, M. Narayanan, qui est ancien gouverneur du Bengal occidental en Inde, mais aussi conseiller de sécurité du Premier ministre, poursuivra. Alors, on a un petit contretemps avec notre collègue Jamal Khashoggi de Al Arab News Channel, qui, je l'espère, va nous rejoindre dans quelques minutes. Il sera suivi par M. Wang Jije, qui est le président de l'Institut d'études internationales et stratégiques à l'Université de Pékin et professeur dans cette université. Et nous terminerons, ça n'est pas tout à fait l'ordre qui est indiqué dans le programme, par l'intervention de M. Jehangir Khan, qui est le directeur du UN Counter-Terrorism Implementation Task Force et du UN Counter-Terrorism Center, et qui nous apportera, qui nous expliquera quelle est la vision des Nations Unies, et en particulier les plans développés par le secrétaire général, plans qu'il est chargé de mettre en œuvre. Nous irons donc en quelque sorte du plus général et du plus philosophique, dirais-je, ou du plus analytique, vers ce qui constitue la vision actuelle de ce problème-là, du problème du terrorisme, par les Nations Unies. Donc, sans attendre davantage, je laisse la parole à Sergei Karaganov pour les 8 minutes réglementaire. Sergei.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. First of all, I'm delighted to be here, and I'm very happy that the World Policy Conference lives and thrives. On terrorism, there are basically in the modern world two types of terrorism. One is, a terrorism which Justin has mentioned. I mean terrorist attacks, which are vicious, which are growing, which are growing the dangerous, and which are they're happening all over the world, especially, of course, in the larger Middle East, but also now more and more in Europe. They have been often in Russia and other places. And a second type, I would say, terrorism is organized or massive terrorism, when terrorist organizations which provide, I mean, first type of terrorism, take over territories and countries, and become then the threat, the direct threat to humanity. We have had that kind of terrorism even before, that rarely. I mean, because of injustice and economic suffering, Germany has become a terrorist state. I mean, before that and after that, we have had racist and nationalist regimes in Europe, but Hitler regime was quite something different. It was a classic terrorist regime. It didn't use the modern terrorist tactics, but it was a classic terrorist regime. So how to deal with the first type of terrorism, it's clear, though it is very difficult. It is a work of security services, police, and maximum coordination. How to deal with the second type of terrorism is a big issue. But before addressing that second issue, I must say that, I mean, in this concrete situation we have, of course, a clear case of this new kind of terrorism, which not so no new kind, which again appeared about 30 years ago. It was first Mujahideen, then Taliban, then Al-Qaeda, Al-Nusra, now Daesh. And it is highly likely that it will have something else, unless we learn the lessons from the past. The reasons for this, for arrival of this new type of terrorism, as well as the first type of terrorism, are relatively clear. Injustice, social inequality in this area, in this particular area of the world. It is also, of course, a growth of a demographic problem. I mean, on the background of economy lagging, cultural problems, climate change decreases production of food in this huge area, creating new masses of unsatisfied people who go to the streets. So this is the. You should deal with these kind of sources of terror, but they will be with us, and you could not deal with them, do away with them totally. But this time, and as well as in the previous times, like Al-Qaeda and Taliban before, these huge terrorist organizations, which actually took over territories, were also the result of unjustified, totally incompetent and irresponsible intrusion by foreign powers. Soviet Union, my former country, did contribute when it went into Afghanistan, but thanks God we have done away with the IDC of communism and its gerontocracy. But now we have had, during the last several years, I mean, a new kind of series of ideological intrusions which are, as I've said, unbelievably irresponsible and incomprehensible. Of course, Iraq, which actually created, and then which ended up in throwing away the cadres of Ba'ath regime. We had Libya. We had support of Arab Spring, which could have only brought disaster, but of course was widely supported and thrived for a while. And now we have, of course, the same situation in Syria developing. So my first recipe for dealing with this issue is stop interventions under whatever ideological banner they come, whether it's communism, democratism, or future isms to come to this world. They bring only disaster. Respect the local traditions and customs. The aim should not be change but stability, only change and development could come only under circumstances of stability and peace. That is the lesson we should learn from the past, but where from to the future? Well, Russia is doing what it believes it should do, and also for the future. We have went to Syria for several reasons, but the one of the reasons is to destroy terrorist organizations and terrorist institutions at their core, rather than before they come to our territory. There will and prop up existing states and existing legitimate governments and stop their irresponsible policies of regime changes, which have been performed by our partners. We are succeeding. If you wish, I will later. If you wish, do I have three more minutes? What should be the principles of our future policy? Well, first of all, as I've said, common goal stability. When fighting terrorist organizations of the Daesh type or of the Al-Nusra type, which is thought to be first, not exactly a terrorist, you have to use unlimited force. The aim is to kill and to crush the will of those people who and will and ideology of those people who have taken up arms and against forces of civilization. If you play with these forces, you are doomed to be defeated eventually by them. Then emphasize put emphasis on support of traditional forces and traditional values within the societies. Work with the governments. And of course, forget about the geopolitical games when you're fighting this kind of terrorist threats. It's very hard for everybody, including Russians. We are very good in playing geopolitical games. But in principle, we must understand that if we do not defeat Daesh now, there will be several Daeshes which might be much worse down the road, because their social, economic, and political preconditions for new waves of terrorism are growing. Situation in the middle, in the larger Middle East, has been destabilized for quite some time, and it will be very hard. We could discuss that later to correct it, if it is possible at all. But then we have Central Africa, which is going towards a social disaster again, mostly because of climate, demography, etc., etc., etc. And it will be a fertile ground for terrorism. So, and the final word on that is support existing states which are vulnerable. In this area, I could name only three, but there are many others. And I think it's our friends from this area know that better. I would say that there are three on the top of my list. This is Jordan, of course, Egypt, and Algeria. If we do not support them together with our local, with our friends from this area, but also people from Europe, from Russia, from maybe from China, other places, I mean, we will have a profound and quantitative threat. I mean, just imagine what would have happened if Russia would not have started to destroy all these forces in Syria. By now, al-Nusra and Daesh would have controlled the whole country, would have been in Damascus, and controlling, I mean, the military machine of that government. Imagine what would have happened if almost by the will of Allah or God,
General al-Sisi wouldn't have organized a coup d'etat. By this time, the whole Egypt would have been in flames. So, thank you.
Thank you, Sergei. I think we'll have a lot of substance to discuss, but Mr. Narayanan, the floor is yours. Oh, yeah. Want to go to the podium?
First, I would like to thank your theory and the World Policy Conference for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to take part in this very, very interesting conference. I think this is the fourth occasion that I've been here, and each time it has been a learning experience. Thank you also, Justin, for putting me as a number two on the panel before other more distinguished speakers have their say in the matter. I'll begin by saying that to win a war, you need to know your enemy. And I think ancient philosophers, strategists like Sun Tzu or Kautilya have said this. But it's true every time that you have to deal with terrorists, as Sergei said just now. Terrorists are creating problems which are multidimensional in nature, and we need to understand that. So much of what I'm going to say today is that fighting terrorism requires an understanding of the way terrorism has morphed over the years, for instance. History is both relevant and important in this context. But do realize and understand that while terrorism is not a postmodern phenomenon, the paradigmatic changes that have taken place in the practice of violence has meant that there are profound strategic implications in the ways terrorism is employed today. Let me try to outline the stages one by one. First, I would ask you to throw your mind back to the 80s of the last century. This was when the broad sweep of radical Islamist extremism today received its first impetus. The war against the Soviets in Afghanistan in the 1980s was a major turning point, reflecting as it did a mixture of religious fervor with fundamentalist aims. The Afghan jihad attracted volunteers from across the Islamic world and helped initiate what in subsequent years became a crucial mass of collective jihadist effort based on a combination of experiences across Egypt, Syria, the Arab world, and West Asia overall. This marked the beginnings of the opening of global jihad. Next, we come to new era terrorism, which in a sense began with the September 11, 2001 terror attacks in the United States, and was finished by a series of attacks thereafter, including the one we had in Mumbai in November 2008. Both signified the emergence of a different kind of threat, one of achieving mass casualties and large-scale economic and political disruption rather than drawing attention to a primary cause or primary causes. Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden became the symbols of this new genus of terrorism. Between 2001 and 2011, the Al-Qaeda core and its regional affiliates were responsible for several large-scale terrorist attacks in different regions of the globe. Third, as the Al-Qaeda core started to weaken following the elimination of Osama bin Laden, internal tensions in the Al-Qaeda core emerged, and this led to the emergence of what we now call the Islamic State phenomenon. The theology of the Islamic State was not very different from that of the Al-Qaeda, both being influenced by the nihilistic teachings of the Egyptian Sayyid Qutb and the Palestinian Abdullah Azam. But the ISIS combined this with the practical theology of the Afghan warlord Jalaluddin Haqqani. I would say that the real fundamental difference between ISIS and earlier versions of terrorism is the fact that they paraded an exclusivist brand of puritanical Islam. The idea of a new caliphate, themes such as hijrah and bayah, and overall gave a complete new dimension to what they meant by modern Islamic ideas. This has proved to be a very powerful magnet in attracting Muslim youth from across the world. I would urge this audience to understand and recognize the fact that the Islamic State is a unique entity. It is very different from other terrorist organizations. It believes in holding territory. It, in effect, projects an Islamic State prototype. Its recruitment techniques, the employment of dark propaganda in its videos for purposes of recruitment and propaganda, its proselytization methods over the internet, all have created a virtual community of fanatical sympathizers. I do not think that the world has ever seen self-radicalization on this scale. And I think there are no markers to indicate how and where this would end or where this would lead the world to. Violence is a leitmotif of the ISIS, beginning with the highly publicized campaigns of beheading civilian hostages. It has carried out some of the most spectacular killings in the past 2.5 years. Sergei made some reference to this just now. I do not think that I should repeat the horrors of 2015 and 2016, too recent in our memories. What has happened is that the success of the ISIS is, in turn, leading to a resurgence of other terrorist organizations. The Al-Qaeda, for instance, which was in decline, is showing signs of a revival. The ISIS and Al-Qaeda are now establishing contact with a host of other terrorist outfits and formations across Asia and Africa, and perhaps Europe as well. I believe that the Al-Qaeda is even thinking or considering declaring an Islamic emirate to counter the ISIS caliphate. In conclusion, I think we need to acknowledge that terrorism is becoming more asymmetric, even as newer terrorist groups emerge. Both the ostentatious brutality of the ISIS and the relatively softer jihadism of the Al-Qaeda pose not merely law and order threats, but also a kind of civilization tsunami, considering the way we run our affairs. Countering the enduring myth of the ISIS, namely that of a Puritan Islamist entity, is not going to be easy. The threat that the ISIS posits is that it is not just an organization, it is an idea. I think we need to understand this. When the ISIS encounters setbacks, it will morph into ISIS 2.0 and continue to stage more attacks. If the ISIS is defeated in Syria, the conditions that created the ISIS will not just disappear. A generation of disaffected youth willing to wage other future struggles already exists. They will stream out of their present habitat in Asia and Africa to other regions, including Europe and the United States. The lone wolf syndrome will become a very persistent threat and danger. I urge you to realize that the internet will become a crucial weapon in the hands of the ISIS once it morphs into ISIS 2.0. Already, the ISIS has plans to use the deep web and the dark net. The latter would, in ISIS 2.0, become a vicious instrument in the hands of the ISIS to engage in cyber terrorism. Finally, I would say that terrorism will be the defining threat of not merely the present, but future generations as well. Terrorist groups in the future, as seen in the case of the ISIS, are likely to increasingly justify their brutality as evolutionary adaptations to an unimaginably dangerous social environment. Consequently, countering the appeal of pernicious ideas such as those of ISIS will be the greatest challenge facing humanity. How does one fight an idea or wage an effective war against radical philosophies or dangerous philosophies such as those espoused by the ISIS? Not by using drones, and not only by through violence. The battle will have to be fought with ideas. We need better ideas, more relevant ideas. This is not happening at present. Ladies and gentlemen, this is no 30-year war or a mere generation-long struggle. The conflict will be a long drawn-out one, and we and the world must prepare for a much longer haul. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Narayanan. Generally, when we want to be sort of pessimistic and draw people's attention to the fact that it will be a long struggle, we say, you know, it's going to be a 30-year war, and you're telling us it's more than a 30-year war. So sort of raised up the ante, and it's quite frightening. Without further ado, I'll leave the floor now to Jamal Khashoggi, and happy that he could finally join us.
Oh, sorry for coming late, but all right. I hope this will not. I'm sure it will not be a 30 years old war. It has been already a 30-year-old war, and that is due to the fact that we've been using the wrong approach. There are two approaches to fight terrorism: the current one, which had been going on for the last 20 years or 25 years, depending where you start counting, from 9/11. Or from the mid-90s, from the first strike by the Clinton administration on Jalalabad or in Sudan, a bombing of Al-Qaeda targets. If the current approach was given results, was successful, we wouldn't have more terrorism today. So that is an indicative that it is not going well. This approach is failing. And the proof of that, we have more terrorists. Not only that, for the first time, terrorism has transformed from organization into state, holding lands, holding territories. So this approach is not working. We have to admit that. What is the other approach I'm suggesting, which I think is more appropriate? It is more complicated, it is very comprehensive. I could call it fix the Arab world approach. We have to go for the root cause of the problem. The root cause of the problem is chaos, anarchy. Yes, it is true that terrorism predated anarchy that happened in Syria and Iraq and in Libya in the form of Al-Qaeda and 9/11. But again, let's remember there was a form of anarchy in Afghanistan, that the world after the Russian withdrawal, the Soviet withdrawal from Afghanistan, the West almost totally ignored Afghanistan and left it in chaos. Chaos and anarchy that existed in Afghanistan from 92 to 2001 provided a haven for Al-Qaeda and terrorism. So anarchy somehow was there in Afghanistan. The world could have done something. They could have fixed Afghanistan, but nobody was interested at that time in fixing Afghanistan. I remember the late Ahmad Shah Massoud, who was a mainstream Muslim jihadist, in the good sense of the word, went around the world, came to Europe before a few months before 9/11, seeking help. Nobody listened to him. He was ignored. Then 9/11 happened. At that time, 2 days before 9/11 happened, Ahmad Shah Massoud was assassinated. And the rest we know. So fixing anarchy, fixing the Arab world is the solution. But I will go back to the current approach. The current approach, what we have right now, is head-on. It's just to bomb Al-Qaeda, to bomb ISIS, to assassinate them, use drones. If we take, for example, what the Russians have been doing in Syria for the last year, they did not liberate much of land from ISIS. There were more lands liberated from ISIS, freed from ISIS, in the hands of the Syrians, who were supported by Turkey, or the Kurds, who were supported by the Americans, than territories liberated by the Russians. In fact, the Russians were more busy; they were busier bombing people in Aleppo. So there got to be something wrong. It is the people who have the motive to free themselves from ISIS. Not the Russians, not the Americans, the Syrian people, not even the Gulf countries, not even the Syrian people, the Iraqi people, the Libyan people. They are the ones who are demanding to be free of ISIS. ISIS is not the future of the Arab world. The future of the Arab world is what we witnessed in Tahrir Square in Egypt in 2011. There were no sign of ISIS, no sign of Al-Qaeda, no picture of Osama bin Laden. People wanted democracy in the Western sense of democracy. That's what the people are looking for. But because we did not support the people at that junction in history, chaos and anarchy prevailed in some areas in the Arab world. So Al-Qaeda and later ISIS became the alternative. This approach make world leaders, make strategists lose vision, lose strategic vision. When they are in the middle of this approach, they will lose ethical values, and they will begin to say, we will choose Bashar for now before we counter ISIS. Bashar before ISIS, or ISIS before Bashar. That's what to correct myself. That is wrong, because, for example, the tyrant is part of the problem. It is what begot ISIS. It is what his actions, his bad administration, his failures, his injustice, that what led to the chaos in Syria or the chaos in Iraq or the chaos in Libya, and the result was ISIS. So this approach distort our vision and make many world leaders say the wrong statement. ISIS first, then Bashar. Now they even have become more accepting of Bashar and more insisting on targeting ISIS. And in fact, nobody is targeting ISIS right now in Syria except the Syrian people. This approach leads to more chaos, and that is exactly what is happening in Syria. That is exactly what could happen more in Iraq. In Iraq, for us to lose vision, strategic vision, it makes us not see what Iran is doing in the region. Iran expansionism, Iran hegemony in the region, it is not being seen. Because of this current approach, we do not see the radical Shia groups who are as bad as ISIS. The only difference between them and ISIS, that the radical Shia groups who are as hateful, as violent, they don't target Westerns, while the Sunni radicals target Westerns, so they become a threat. While the radical Shia radicals who are fighting in Syria, who are fighting in Iraq, who are exercising their hegemony, who are leading to more chaos and more disturbance in the regions are not to be seen. That is an indicative of how this current vision make us lose strategic planning. So what I think we should go for is to go for the approach of fixing the Arab world, targeting anarchy first. This approach include elements of the first approach. Of course, you will also continue on targeting the radicals, on to eliminating them, into fighting them. But at the same time, you must have a plan to fix the Arab world completely, to bring it back from tyranny, from injustice, from imprisonments, from failing economies. Unless we do that, the cycle will continue. Let's remember, the first terrorist attack that made us know of Al-Qaeda happened in mid-90s. That is 30 years ago. So it is already a 30 years old. So we must change course and adapt a more comprehensive course that lead or that concentrate on fixing the problem from scratch. I will just finish now with that everyone has its ISIS. Why I'm putting so much emphasis on chaos and anarchy? Yes, we have a very mean, brutal, ugly form of extremism. But in every society, there is an element of an outlaw groups who are willing to use violence against the system. But in Europe or in Montana or in France, or they are small in numbers. But if, God forbid, in your peace-loving countries that enjoy stability and enjoy law and order, if anarchy for some reason prevail in some part of France, those radicals will emerge. That's why our radicals emerge in our region. It is not because we, the Arabs, are radical in hiding. It's just because the system has collapsed. So we need to bring back the system. Bringing back the system, it is not to stand by tyrants like Bashar, like Gaddafi of Libya, who is out of the picture, but again, we are supporting other small tyrants in Libya, or Ali Abdullah Saleh of Yemen. They are not the solution, they are the problem, and other Arab leaders. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's continue the list, and Professor Wang Shishe, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chairman. I think anti-terrorism has taken a higher place in China's domestic agenda. It occupies a higher place in a priority list. And last year, I think that was November 2015, China's People's Congress passed a law called the Anti-Terrorism Law. It defines terrorism, it has a lot of measures and a lot of principles expressed there. But there is not a lot of public available information about terrorist attacks in activities in China, or not very much coverage of terrorist activities abroad for political reasons. And so my information is based on some anecdotal stories told by my friends who are doing research in that area, or some isolated cases I learned from some sources. For one thing, which is not publicly discussed or available, we found that some suspects or suspected terrorists in the last few years moved from Xinjiang to a southwest province in China called Yunnan. And they managed to stay there for a few days. They had some connections, and they smuggled themselves from Yunnan to part of Thailand. And then from Thailand, they found their way to the Middle East. And some of them, or quite a few of them, became a member of Al-Qaeda or Daesh. And some of them wanted to come back to China. So that worried the Chinese leadership very much. But still, we don't have public available information about that. The only thing I know and I can tell is that the security situation in that part of China has been worsening in the past few years. And Chinese leaders send their envoys and their representatives, including a Politburo member of the Communist Party Central Committee, to neighboring countries, to some countries like Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, to talk about security in those countries, in China, and cooperation between China and those countries in fighting terrorism. Still, we don't know very much about what is really going on. I think the Chinese government is very careful not to, to invite trouble. And that's why in our central television reports every night, when there are terrorist attacks, we don't name those organizations like ISIS or other local organizations. We simply call them extremist groups or extremist organizations without specifying their identity. We have the translation of Al-Qaeda, but don't have the right translation for other organizations. That is very carefully done. So what China does in fighting terrorism, first we give humanitarian aid to refugees and those victims of terrorist attacks, including our support to humanitarian activities in bordering Jordan and elsewhere. But it is not beyond China's capacity to join military operations. We are neither joining the United States nor Russia in their military operations in Syria. Of course, there are some quiet discussions among some people I know that in the future China may need to send military forces to rescue its own people or safeguard its companies or citizens abroad in those hot spots. But so far, there are no military actions, they are still in the period of discussing establishing some kind of rapid deployment force or something like that. And China's principle is very clear, that is, we support legitimate governments of all these countries, China doesn't really want to have more Arab Springs or any movements aimed at undermining legitimate governments in this country or that country. And as China's special envoy to the Middle East, Ambassador Gong Xiaosheng said yesterday, China wanted to be nice to everybody, to every government in the region. China does not really want to take side. And nowadays we are talking about One Belt, One Road. And the foreign ministry, rather than other ministries, is taking charge of coordinating different government agencies in China to protect Chinese citizens and companies abroad. And there are, to the best of my knowledge, there are also private-owned security companies established in China. Now there are many, quite a few, that are operating. But I think that we are more concerned about our neighboring countries. We sometimes mention Pakistan and Afghanistan and Central Asian states as something we should be more concerned about. Because the One Belt, One Road, a great part of it is called the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. And the corridor passed through from Xinjiang to the Indian Pakistan occupied Kashmir region, all the way from Kashmir to Afghanistan to Pakistan to Gwadar port and to the Middle East, and that is a very important route for China to be concerned about. And China also wants to keep some good balance between India and Pakistan in their disputes about who should be identified as terrorist organizations and so on. So when I visited India, they made some quiet protest against some Chinese positions. But then, of course, we are. Pakistan is a very, very good friend of China, and we want to maintain this relationship. At the same time, we understand the sensitivities on the part of India and some other neighboring countries, and that is what I really want to share with you today. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll end this first round of interventions with Jehangir Khan, who will tell us what the vision, not only the view, but also the vision from the UN is.
Thank you very much. I feel honored to speak after such a distinguished panel of experts and speaking on behalf of the United Nations, I would like to first of all convey the very warm greetings of His Excellency the Secretary General of the United Nations, Mr. Ban Ki-moon, who in fact has participated in this forum in the past. And so it's an honor for the United Nations to be able to participate and to speak today on this very important subject. In doing so, I'd like to thank the government of the state of Qatar for their very warm hospitality. It provides a lot of support to our United Nations Counter-Terrorism Center. In fact, it has just announced a very generous contribution to our center. It reflects the leadership of Qatar in fighting terrorism. And I also want to thank the sponsors of this forum, in particular the French Institute of International Relations, for inviting us. Distinguished friends and colleagues, why are we speaking about terrorism today? Let me first start with the preface that the reason why we are concerned for terrorism is because it has a human face. And what is that human face? It is the face of the victim, who too often is forgotten in the wide intellectual policy debates that take place around the world. If we reflect today that, in fact, this very day, there have been terrorist attacks in Mali, in which people have been killed, in Afghanistan, in which people have been killed, and even over the past week, in my own country, in Pakistan, in the Islamic Republic of Pakistan, there was a huge attack. Almost every single day, individuals, men, women, and especially children are being killed. If you look at what is happening in Syria, in Aleppo, or in Iraq, in Mosul. So we have a duty and a responsibility not just to talk about terrorism, not to just hypothesize, but the time has come for action. Not only action, the time has come for a call to unity in action,
Now, there is a lot of rhetoric about terrorism and a manipulation of terrorism for many different reasons, for which I will not go to here. But I wish to submit a number of propositions to you as friends who are concerned about terrorism. First of all, not only does terrorism have a human face, it is also a phenomenon in which the primary victims of terrorism are Muslims today. And the primary forces who are fighting against terrorism are indeed here in the Muslim world, here in the state of Qatar and around the world, as I said earlier. And so we are all in it together. And at the United Nations, there is one principle that we believe in, and that the Secretary General of the United Nations has underlined, that terrorism and violent extremism has no religion, has no faith, has no ethnicity, has no culture. It is a pure evil in itself, and every society throughout history has experienced extremism and terrorism. So let us not malign any particular religion or any particular region of the world. That is why I'm saying this is a call to unity and a call to action. And if we reflect today, what is the quality and nature of terrorism? And I hate to use this word quality. It is an evolving phenomenon, a dynamic phenomenon. It is becoming at the epicenter of conflicts. In fact, we see today a vicious vortex developing between protracted conflicts, the exploitation of those conflicts by terrorist groups, and the further proliferation of violent extremism around the world. Here is a very damning statistic. Today, there are foreign terrorist fighters, more than 30,000 of them, coming from more than 100 countries. That tells us that terrorism is not located in one region, that terrorism is a global phenomenon. And we are, and we have to be, looking at this and take a global approach to this spreading global disease. And if we are to address this vicious vortex between, as I said, protracted conflicts, if you look at what is happening in Syria, or you look in Iraq, or in Libya, or in Somalia, in Afghanistan, the conflict has been going on for more than 30 years. So, distinguished friends, let us ask ourselves, are we in a better place since 9/11, or in a worse place? I think you know the answer to that when you see military operations, pitched battles going on in two of the cities of Syria and Iraq. In fact, the second largest city of Syria, which is Aleppo, and the second largest city of Iraq, which is Mosul. Cities that are of millions of people and which thousands of innocent civilians, children, women, and men are dying. And so the answer, if I may say so, to the question of are we better off than 9/11 or worse off, to which I believe you have the answer, is the question is what do we do about it? If you look at the response of the international community since 9/11, that response has been centered on one word, and that word is counter. Counter-terrorism, counter-extremism, counter-radicalization. And I submit to you, distinguished friends, that the word counter has been a response. We are reacting whilst the terrorists have the initiative. And that reaction has been mostly a military security response. And that clearly has its limits. And so the Secretary General of the United Nations, His Excellency Mr. Ban Ki-moon, has worked over the last year and mobilized the whole United Nations system to present a new approach. And that approach is centered on one word. And it's in the antidote to the counter approach. It is the word prevention. Now, that's common sense. That's common sense that we should be taking a preventive approach. But the time has come to mainstream the prevention approach, not to make it a lip service, but to take action on it. And so the Secretary General of the United Nations presented to the General Assembly of the United Nations a few months ago a United Nations global plan of action to prevent violent extremism, what we call PVE. And why is that? Because we see that insidious ideologies, as those perpetrated by ISIS, Boko Haram, Al-Shabaab, and many other groups, are fueling terrorism. And so the time has come for us to really look upstream at the drivers of violent extremism. As Mr. Khashoggi just pointed out to us, the word root causes. And here the Secretary General has underlined the importance of a number of strategic priorities. First of all, we need to look at our youth. Today, the world has 1.8 billion youth. It is the largest population of young people in the history of mankind. The 16 to 24-year-old demographic is the primary prey of terrorist groups such as Daesh. And we must look at how do we engage with youth, not as a negative, but as a positive, because I submit to you that most young people are not ticking time bombs. They aspire for the very same things that all young people have aspired for, which is to pursue a dream to change the world. And we must respond to the crying call of young people today, because today they have a new Molotov cocktail, which is carried in this, the social media. Between the aspirations of youth and social media, they have the means to change the world. And that is why Daesh is ahead of us in targeting young people and maligning them and mobilizing them to create disorder in the world, as one of my speaker friends said just now. So we are now looking at taking an inclusive approach. When we look at youth, we need to look at other aspects, gender, employment, skills development, engaging local communities. All of these are outlined in more than 70 recommendations that the Secretary General has presented to the UN General Assembly, which responded resoundingly by a consensus resolution in July. And we, my United Nations Counter-Terrorism Center, is now moving to work with governments around the world to look at how can we respond to promote the development of regional and national plans of action to prevent violent extremism. And here I will tell you that we as the United Nations also have to be extremely humble in recognizing that there is no one clear pathway to the defeat of terrorism or to mobilizing the prevention of violent extremism. Every society, every country must have national ownership. Even the most powerful countries in the world do not have a clear answer on how to deal with this. But what we may need to look at is our methodologies, is our political approaches. Ultimately, terrorism is not a military problem. It is not a technical problem. It is a political problem in the first instance. We must look at what political policies we collectively as the international community and each government is pursuing. Because ultimately, terrorism must have a political solution. In fact, in many of the countries where there is disorder, as one of my colleagues said, and where there is conflict, these are the places where terrorists prey. So we must look at taking inclusive political solutions in which all groups, especially marginalized groups, those who feel disenfranchised, foremost of which are youth, must feel that they can participate and contribute in a constructive way. Time is short, dear friends, and therefore I will conclude. Let me just say that I would like to end where I started, which is the point about victims. And why is the issue of victims important? Today, we see children, babies, washed away in the seas of the Mediterranean on the shores of Europe. We have a moral responsibility not to see children floating in the seas of the Mediterranean and other seas. And therefore, we must look at our own actions before we look at the actions of others and see how is it that we are contributing to the effort, the global effort. The United Nations stands ready to work with you to mobilize that global effort. And that is, in a very small way, why the Secretary General has presented his UN plan of action. But a plan by itself means nothing. It must have resonance and, most importantly, impact. And where does that impact matter? It matters in terms of victims. And why does it matter? Because we must prevent, ultimately, victims. That's what prevention is all about. If we are to measure how we are doing in fighting terrorism, we must measure it by the number of victims that we are preventing. And if today the number of victims is growing exponentially, then we must again look at our policies and ask ourselves, what is it that we are doing? Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Khan. So we have about 15, 20 minutes. And before we go to the room, I'd like to ask a few questions to our panelists, and perhaps in reverse order, perhaps quick questions with quick answers, and then we'll move to the public. To Mr. Khan, I think it would be really interesting if you could tell us a bit more about the center and the task force, that is, how they are actually working, how they're interacting with governments, and give us a more precise view of the work they're doing so that the audience might become more familiar with them. To Professor Wang Zhizhe, I'd like to push you just a bit further on Pakistan. Recently, China blocked the inscription of an affiliate from Hizb ut-Tahrir to the UN terrorism list. And so there is indeed a question that is posed to cooperation to fight against terrorism. What do you see as the future of Chinese-Pakistan relation as it relates precisely to that question of terrorism? To Jamal Khashoggi, I'd like to ask you about one thing that Saudi Arabia is doing, which is de-radicalization. De-radicalization is sort of the graal for many governments around the world. Does it exist? That is, prevention of terrorism, as Ban Ki-moon would insist we need to do, is something. But de-radicalization, that is, intervening ex post after someone has been radicalized, seems a very high challenge that has not been properly managed by pretty much anyone. And if you have, if you could enlighten us on this, that would be interesting. To Mr. Narayanan, I really appreciated your point about the need to defeat philosophies, these pernicious religious ideologies and philosophies. So the fight is not just about security and judicial cooperation and police, but also about ideology, which is part of the problem. If you had to elaborate a bit further on what that exactly mean, or rather, what are the, let's say, the tracks that we could think of to go in this direction of defeating philosophies. Defeating ideas is a pretty arduous task, and if you had other ideas, it would be really interesting. And last but not least, Sergei, I'd like to push you a bit on the Russian intervention in Syria, because you talked about the need to stop foreign interventions, and it seems that Russia is doing just that, intervening. And more precisely on the question of Aleppo, Stefan de Mistura estimated the number of al-Nusra fighters in Aleppo, in East Aleppo, to about 400 maximum out of 5,000 to 8,000 fighters in East Aleppo. That is, they are really about 5% to a maximum of 10%, to less than 10% actually, of the fighters. So it seems that the fierce fight against the rebels in Aleppo is not really about fighting al-Nusra, but really about what the other aim that you mentioned, that is to say supporting existing government. And I say existing because you said legitimate government, and I'm not sure that the government of Bashar al-Assad, especially with what's happening right now, can be considered legitimate. And so do you really think it's a long-term solution, a minority government that is hated by a lot of people in Syria, or do you think it's part of the problem, more as Jamal Khashoggi was suggesting? Perhaps we could start by this and go in reverse order.
Thank you for the question. First of all, of course, I do not know the figures, and I, with all my great respect, I don't trust anybody, including my own press, because it is a, I mean, we are living in a fog of war, but it quite be possible that he's right. So what we are doing is we're defeating terrorism, and we are defending a legitimate government, and we are stopping the practice of which has been imposed on the world during the last 15 years of regime change. I hope that with that lesson, others will stop that process. I mean, it started with 1999 with a criminal, indiscriminate bombing of Yugoslavia. Now we're deterring that kind of practices so that nobody in the world will ever think that could be repeated. As to the legitimacy of the government is there. It is recognized by the UN and international community, which will be the future government of that country when we impose some kind of peace and order, and if it is imposable, of course. We do not know, and we will not impose that kind of government. So we are not there for Mr. Assad. We are there, though I remember very well that some countries which are great friends of ours were from the beginning saying that Assad should go. We are not saying that Assad should stay. We are there for, principles and for interests, and including one very important principle which has been grossly violated during the last 17 or 18 years, and that is respect for sovereignty. Never repeat such acts like attack on Belgrade. It was worse than Guernica.
Thanks. Mr. Narayanan, a few thoughts on defeating ideologies.
The question is perhaps the most difficult to answer, because if we had the answer, then we wouldn't be in the position that we are in today. But I just want to make the point that there are many different varieties of terrorism, and the world has gone and seen this, and I think Sergei and others know this only too well. You have ethnic terrorism, you have terrorism based on nationalist and linguistic terrorism and so on. I concentrated on one particular because most of the others were limited in scope. They're confined to particular areas, states, etc. I mean, let's see the Chechen rebels or we have problems in in India, for instance, of people who feel that they're not getting their due and their own for us self-preservation sort of issue. I talked basically of thinking which is really going across countries, territories, and is winning people over by appealing to what I would call a conceptual kind of thing. A new world is being built. And the internet, I think almost every minute, probably a few hundred thousand children are being taken away into this. And they're all being carried away by a holy grail kind of thing. It's completely different. And where the means are of no consequence, we have to achieve the end. So that's why I concentrated on just this one particular point of terrorism, because others have been dealt with by states in different ways, some better, some worse, some continue, some not. Concessions have been made. But this one, there is really no, because it's really an idea. An idea has been floated that we are producing a world which is very fundamentally different from what you've seen, and therefore you join us. And for that, you can kill, you can do anything, you can do what happened in Belgium or what happened in France or what's happening in different parts of the world. And it's a little more than what Mr. Khashoggi said about problems in a particular region. This is going across regions. Now, it's happening not only in West Asia, it's happening right across the world. So it's really an issue of how do people have gotten this idea? How do you meet that idea? And it's dangerous because if it goes on in this point, so we need to find an idea. I think that is not being attended to. I think the best brains and the best minds need to really work on this. How do you get people, because you can't monitor the internet. I mean, children are sitting in their rooms at ages of 14 and 13 and listening to what's coming, the siren song almost as it is.
So I think we need to look at it from that point of view. I think that's the general sense here, that mere military might or using force, I think Mr. Khashoggi mentioned it in very stark detail, is not going to win us the war. We'll win a battle here in a bit, but we may, as I said, get back Mosul. But as I said, ISIS 2.0 is going to come all over to every other part of the world, and we still have the problem on us. So I think we need it. All I would think that the conference should, if it's possible, probably Mr. Jehangir Khan should be the right person saying, yes, how do we marshal our forces to think of meeting the idea? Because they have the vehicle and they're using it. The vehicle is the internet. We need to get an idea and use similar vehicles to defeat. That's all that I have to thank you.
Thank you very much. Jamal Khashoggi on de-radicalization.
Radicalization program is used not for implicated violent activists who are who been tried and committed to long sentences or even to execution after they carried a violent attack. It applied to young activists, radicals, who like attempted to cross the border from Turkey to Syria, and they are caught by the Turkish border guards and handed over to Saudi Arabia. Those ones, the Saudi government, they have carried out a crime because we have a law in Saudi Arabia that prevent joining war in out of the country. So they have violated the law, and they will be sentenced no matter what to a few years in prison. But it's going to be a 3 or 4 or 5 year sentence. So eventually they will come out of the prison. At that time, they will go through a course of radicalization. The government knows that they will eventually come out, so they are a potential hazard to the society. Some succeed, some fail. The rate varies. The last percentage I saw in a local newspaper that there had 15% failures and 85% success of most of the released detainees of the program. Also, another small another big segment of individuals who enjoy this program, I don't know if the word enjoy is correct, are the one who are supporters of radicalism, who were caught tweeting or writing on social media in support to Al-Qaeda. They were not caught supporting Al-Qaeda organization, or they are not even part of the Al-Qaeda organization or ISIS organization. Those also will be arrested and go through the program. And in brief, radicals sometimes grow out of radicalism. It is not something you live up all your life in it.
Thank you. Professor Wang Jishu on Pakistan.
I'm not in a position to discuss specific cases, but in our relationship with Pakistan, I think the principle is that Pakistan is probably the most important and close friend we have in the Islamic world as a whole. And Pakistan gives China valuable support in many, many international settings. And in return, China has strengthened its cooperation in military, economic, and political terms with Pakistan. So we have to discuss very specific cases, some sensitive cases with the Pakistani government, although we also understand there are sometimes different opinions within Pakistan itself. And also we have specific sporadic activities in Pakistan. For instance, some anti-China demonstrations in parts of Pakistan related to China's commercial activities. So there's a very very close consultation between the two governments, taking also the consideration of China's relationship with India and with Afghanistan. That's the principle.
Thank you very much. And last, Mr. Khan, so on the day-to-day work at the UN at your center and task force.
Thank you. I will not bore you with the small details of the day-to-day work of our center, but what I'll explain to you is what is the context. The context is, as I explained, there is today a great deficit in international cooperation relative to the growing transnational threat of terrorism. What do I mean by that? Well, as I explained, the nature of terrorism is increasingly across borders. As we see the bombing taking place in Syria and Iraq, we see terrorists moving across borders. Sometimes they can move across four or five borders very quickly, and they look for new opportunities. When you have terrorists coming from more than 100 countries, that in itself is an evidence. So what is the relevance of my center, the United Nations Counter-Terrorism Center? Well, our main effort is to strengthen international collaboration in a practical way. And it is based on a very concrete mandate that comes from the United Nations General Assembly. You know that until today, there is no agreed definition, no international agreed definition of terrorism. At the United Nations, for years, the legal committee has been debating forever what is the definition of terrorism. And why? And we know what the reasons why there is no definition is because one man's terrorist has been another man or another woman's liberation fighter, and vice versa. And so notwithstanding the fact that there is no agreed international or United Nations definition of terrorism, the General Assembly of the United Nations, all the member states of the United Nations, still managed to adopt a global consensus document called the Global Counterterrorism Strategy. That was adopted 10 years ago. And our job as the United Nations, my Counterterrorism Implementation Task Force that coordinates 38 UN agencies, is to support member governments in implementing the Global Counterterrorism Strategy at the global, regional, and national levels. And that is now being complemented by the new United Nations plan to prevent violent extremism. One last point in this context is that the UN Global Counterterrorism Strategy, its first pillar is called conditions conducive. The reason it's called conditions conducive is because member states could not even agree to call it root causes. That in itself was politicized at the United Nations because some countries were not comfortable with the word root causes, and they had to adopt another terminology called conditions conducive. And for the last 10 years, that first pillar remained moribund until member states finally responded to the call by the Secretary General to look at, in effect, root causes by addressing the drivers of violent extremism. And that is why now the plan of action to prevent violent extremism is meant to give content to that first pillar of the UN Global Counterterrorism Strategy. And our UN Counterterrorism Center now is working across the world, including here with the eminent state of Qatar. I've come here to sign an agreement on how we can strengthen our collaboration to step up our efforts to support governments around the world in preventing violent extremism.
Thanks very much. We have time for just a few questions, and we'll take them in turn. I see Mr. Matt Issa from Malaysia in the first round. If you could bring a microphone, thank you. First question.
Thank you. I'm from Malaysia, representing the Global Movement of Moderates, a Malaysian initiative in providing CV and PVE, and we are following very much, very close. The development in the UN, especially the last meeting in Geneva. And in echoing what Mr. Jamal has mentioned about the need for us to solve the issues according to the language of the day, I think this is what is very much needed now as far as counter-narrative is concerned, and especially narrative that are related to religion. I'm not seeing much of that being done in as far as CVE, or PVE in our counter-narrative. So if that could be promoted, especially from you know, Saudi, from Qatar, that will be a good effort because of the attraction that this narrative are being exposed to youth, especially in that part of the world. As you know, that they are very attractive now, or they're very attracted now in Malaysia, in Indonesia, in southern Thailand. The second thing is, in again, echoing to what Mr. Khan has mentioned about victims, I think one part we need to expose or let the world know about victims, but we also need to expose the actor of, you know, act of terrorism. Being a Muslim, I feel embarrassed now. You know, the topic of the discussion is about terrorism, but the whole concentration is about Muslim terrorists. No single word was mentioned or about the act of terrorism where the victims are Muslim. For example, the latest situation in Burma, in Myanmar, how the Muslims, the Rakhine, are suffering, the atrocities, the ethnic cleansing that's happening up there. And I think the world need to be open, or need to open their eyes also on the situation in that part of the world and the victims being Muslim and so on and so forth. Thank you.
Thank you. Behind you, the lady in yellow suit.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you for this beneficial panel. I just have a comment, it's not a question, for Mr. Sergei Karaganov. He said, I quote, "Suppose that Sisi didn't prepare coup d'etat, the whole Egypt would have been in flames." I actually strongly disagree to this statement because terrorist bombs in Sinai Peninsula has increased after his coup d'etat, and the number of innocent Egyptian soldiers and other like people there like that die on monthly basis increased, significantly increased. And on the other hand, if we can define, like my own definition, for terrorism as the killing of innocent civilians, so that's exactly what Sisi did when he killed around 1,000 in Rabaa massacre, that the Human Rights Watch report said that it was the worst massacre in Egypt's modern history. So Sisi wasn't the hero that saved Egypt from terrorism, but he was the dictator who killed and violated human rights, but in just like a more formal way. Thank you.
Thanks. The gentleman just the rank in front of you.
Merci beaucoup. I don't know if I will speak in French or English. Yeah, French. Okay. En fait, pour moi, le terrorisme, c'est le plus grand défi du 21e siècle. Ce n'est pas le développement de l'Afrique. L'Afrique va se développer, croyez-nous. C'est le terrorisme qui est le plus grand défi. Et c'est la plus grande menace à la qualité de vie. Parce que quand vous vivez avec autour de vous, vous ne savez pas s'il y a un acte terroriste qui se prépare, vous ne pouvez pas bien vivre. Malheureusement, je dois suivre un peu ce qui a été dit tout à l'heure par le directeur d'Al-Arabiya et tous ceux qui ont parlé, notamment le représentant des Nations Unies. On n'a pas encore attaqué les causes profondes. Jusqu'à aujourd'hui, pour moi, on est peut-être en train de faire de la prévention de court terme, mais la prévention de long terme, c'est comment faire pour que le problème, en fait, disparaisse de la scène. Ça, c'est un combat de longue haleine. On parle des SDG, des Sustainable Development Goals. Pour moi, il faudrait avoir un Sustainable Peace Goals, si je peux dire. Ça commence déjà à l'école. Comment faire pour que la tolérance se développe dans les écoles, qu'on éduque dans tous les pays les jeunes pour s'accepter, pour que celui qui vit en Europe qu'il ne se dise pas que l'islam c'est l'ennemi, etc. Je ne suis pas sûr qu'aujourd'hui la situation soit en tout cas gérée comme il le faut dans les différents États. Donc il faut faire cet effort au niveau culturel, au niveau de l'éducation. Le reste, c'est des agendas intérieurs. Il faut que les pays développent l'emploi des jeunes, etc. Mais le plus important, et c'est le message clé, comment développer la tolérance au niveau mondial. Et ça, je ne suis pas sûr qu'aujourd'hui, il y ait des initiatives fortes au niveau des États.
Merci. D'accord, merci beaucoup. Alfredo Valadao, ici derrière vous. Merci. Et après, on prendra une dernière question. Ça marche.
Yes, respect for sovereignty. I wish that would apply to Ukraine's territorial integrity. But that's not the point. Mr. Karaganov show us two types of terrorism. State terrorism, Hitler, or NGO terrorism, the other, the non-governmental terrorism. I think there's a third type of it, which is much more lethal and pervasive in our world today, which is state-sponsored terrorism. We can see that everywhere, Pakistan, Darfur, and for that matter, I could even put Donbass in it. But the idea is defending existing states in the name of stability and against chaos, yes, that doesn't mean defending existing regimes. We all know that they have regime-sponsored terrorism, and we also know that brutal and totalitarian regimes nurture terrorism, which Assad is the case in point. So there's no way that we can fight terrorism seriously if we don't tackle this problem of state-sponsored terrorism, which is, I think, the most important one today.
Thanks, Alfred.
And which means that the international community, or whatever that means in that term, has to decide on the legitimacy of regimes, not on the legitimacy of states.
Okay, thanks. And one last question, and then we'll have to close, unfortunately, just to your right here.
Merci. Bon, quand j'ai écouté les intervenants, je suis convaincu une fois de plus qu'il est impossible de combattre le terrorisme. Parce que, malheureusement, nous faisons toujours une erreur. Il y a les bons et les mauvais terroristes. Et quand on écoute les intervenants, tout le monde a parlé de la fenêtre de la politique de son État. D'abord, il faut comprendre une chose, que depuis le début de l'histoire, le terrorisme et les terroristes ont été toujours soutenus par les États. Et on parlait du terrorisme, state-sponsored terrorisme. Moi, je dirais qu'il n'y a que ça. Aucun groupe terroriste ne peut se développer sans le soutien d'un groupe, d'un État ou d'un service de renseignement. Donc, il faut prendre ça d'abord comme un constat. Parce que les États, malheureusement, font une guerre asymétrique contre d'autres États via le terrorisme. Et ils utilisent le terrorisme comme un outil diplomatique. Dans le passé, aujourd'hui on parle de terrorisme islamique, tout ça. Parce que dans le passé, l'idéologie était le marxisme et le léninisme. Et les gens faisaient la terreur au nom du marxisme et du léninisme. Après la chute de l'Union soviétique, malheureusement, la religion est à nouveau devenue une valeur politique partout dans le monde chrétien et dans le monde musulman. Et aujourd'hui, on utilise la religion pour faire du terrorisme. Et personne ne peut expliquer qu'un groupe terroriste, sans le soutien d'un État ou d'un service de renseignement, peut se développer. Par exemple, prenons le cas de plusieurs groupes.
Je vais terminer.
Dans les médias ou ailleurs, on parle toujours, par exemple, pour un certain groupe, on parle de terrorisme. Pour d'autres, on parle de combattants de la liberté. Pour d'autres, des guérillas. Nous avons tous, malheureusement, notre part de responsabilité, que ce soit les médias, que ce soit les injures, que ce soit les universitaires ou les chercheurs, parce que nous faisons cette distinction entre les terroristes. Et je vais terminer en disant que si aujourd'hui tout le monde ne condamne pas le terrorisme sans dire mais, parce qu'ils ont commis cet acte terroriste, mais, et essayer de trouver une raison, aucune raison, qu'il soit d'ordre politique, ethnique ou idéologique, ne peut expliquer et ne doit expliquer la tuerie ou la carnage des innocents. Merci.
Merci beaucoup. Alors, je vais me tourner vers le panel et simplement proposer à ça entre vous. Il faut vraiment qu'on arrête bientôt. Peut-être Sergei, qui a été interpellé à deux reprises, de répondre, s'il le souhaite.
I sympathize with your views, but if Muslim Brothers would have kept control of Egypt, we knew where Egypt would have gone. It would have gone all over the country in flames. Most in the world were happy when they were put where they are now.
Thanks. Is there anyone else on the panel that wants to address some of the questions that were put? Many of them were commentaries, but is there anything, Jamal? Do you want? Yep.
The idea of counter-narrative is beautiful, but it will not work effectively. We need it. We always need a counter-narrative. But I think the most effective counter-narrative is to have a working state, a good governance. That what will rule out the logic of the extremist. To have a hope, if not a prosperous society, the hope of a prosperous society. I believe Tunisia, for example, even though it has the evil of radicalism, a little bit here and there, it will grow out of it because the people begin to have hope. The people in any society that they lose hope, no counter-narrative can replace the root causes that will bring back more terrorism. In Syria, for example, today, because of the anarchy that spread all over Syria, radicals have a free haven to spread all their radical ideas to young children even. So we could expect a generation of radicals in Syria because we left Syria in anarchy. If we work to bring back peace and order and stability and support the nationalist Syrian rebels who want a better future for their country, then we can, those nationalist Syrians will be the one who will eradicate radicalism. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This panel comes to a close. Please join me in thanking all the panelists for a very interesting discussion.